Implicit method. So again, we're discretizing this equation. And we substitute in our four difference approximation for the time derivative. And our central difference approximation for the spatial derivative for the ith grid block. Now, in the explicit method on the right-hand side, we made the decision to evaluate those at the nth time step. Now we're going to change that decision. We're going to make the decision to evaluate those at the n plus 1 time step. And that's what makes this implicit. It's implicit because there's n plus 1s on both sides of the equation. So if we rearrange this equation, or if we introduce our eta, right, this is just everybody see how, I mean, I just that took that equation that I put the brace under and just rearranged it so that I put all the n plus 1s on the left-hand side and all the n's on the right-hand side. And this is, you know, traditional. We put the, we did this in the explicit method too, right? We put all the things we know on the right-hand side and all the things we're solving for on the left-hand side, okay? It's just we could do that before in the explicit method. Everything was on the right-hand side. Now, the things we know are here. I'm sorry, the things we don't know are here. The things we want to solve for are the Pn plus 1. So, let's look at our four grid blocks again. And let's write the equation for block one. Okay, so I put my equal sign way over here. So I left a big space here. It'll be clear why I did that in a second. So that's for, I'm going to call it this grid block one. So for grid block two, then, so that's the equation for grid block two. For grid block three, grid block four. So you should notice, you know, if you remember in the explicit method, the equations were uncoupled in space, right? If I just knew the pressures from the previous time steps, I could just solve the equation, right? But these guys are coupled in space. In other words, I can't solve for, you know, the P n plus 1 in the second grid block appears in two equations, right? And so, actually, it appears in three equations. And so you should recognize this. And the reason I wrote this sort of funny, right, I guess you use these big spaces in my equations, you should start to recognize that this is sort of like a matrix equation, that I can then pull out, I can rewrite this equation as a matrix, right, by pulling out the unknowns. You can pull them out into a vector. Now, we still have those boundary conditions. We'll come back to those. What I mean by pull it out, now I can write those same equations. No, I don't want to confuse you. So I'm just going to leave this. I'll tell you what. I'm just going to put a big question mark here. Because that has to do with the boundary condition. And I haven't told you what. Same here. Yeah, this is. Anytime I don't draw the entries, they're zeros.
The second line is flush.
Yes. So, just hopefully you can recognize the structure between. Between this, right now again, there's a question mark because there's no P zero. Right, I can't when I factor out the pressures, you know, or turn them into a vector. There's no P zero, right, and there's no P five. So I have to apply my boundary conditions, and we'll do that just the same way we did before. But I just wanted to sort of show you that I can write this system of equations like a matrix. So maybe I should have went ahead and done the boundary conditions. But so again, if we use our averaging, then this thing becomes, you know, so again, constant pressure here, no flow here, no flux here. So this P0 becomes 2 PB minus P1. And so then if I combine that with, and this is to the n plus 1. So P0 becomes 2 PB minus P1 n plus 1. So then if I combine this term and that term so that it only has P1s, right? This is a known. This is something that's known. It's a boundary condition. So the unknown is the P1 n plus 1. So if I combine those two, then this actually becomes this. I'm trying to write. Combining these two becomes 1 plus 3 eta. P1 n plus 1. And then on the other side of the equation, I have plus 2 eta. PB, because that's a known. So all I did was I plugged this in there and then just rearranged the equation so that I'm leaving the P1 n plus 1 term here. That becomes 1 plus 3 eta P1 n plus 1. And then I move my knowns. The things I know are going to go on the right-hand side of the equation. So then this comes over here. So that's how that equation was modified. And then the same thing if for the no flow condition, just like before, we have that P5 n plus 1 is equal to P4 n plus 1. And so then if I plug that in, then this simplifies to 1 plus eta P4 n plus 1. Okay. And so then, going back here, then I can fill these guys in. So this is 1 plus 3 eta, and this is 1 plus eta. And then I have this additional term over here, 2 eta PB1. So then you might just call this guy A, the matrix A. This is a vector P, n plus 1, right? And this is a vector B, right? So then I just have a matrix equation, A equal to B. What's the solution to that equation? Nobody's had linear algebra? Yeah, it's A inverse times B. So if I multiply on the left by A inverse, both sides of the equation, this becomes the identity matrix. The identity matrix times the vector is just the vector. So then I get P n plus 1 is equal to A inverse B. And so the implicit method, that's what I said, it's harder because now I have to solve a linear system of equations. And this is much harder than the explicit method where I'm just using all the old values. So then the question is, it begs the question, right, why do this? Well, because the explicit method had a stability criterion, right? The implicit method is unconditionally stable. So I can take as large a time step as I want. And the errors, the numerical errors would never grow without bounds. Understand that stability doesn't necessarily mean accuracy. So it just means I can do that. I can take as long a time step as I want, and I will get an answer. It will converge to an answer. But that doesn't necessarily mean to be an accurate answer. Well, the accuracy still follows the rules governed by the finite differencing equations, right? You're going to have second order accuracy in space and first order accuracy in time. Right? That doesn't change. So for higher accuracy, you want smaller grid blocks and shorter time steps. Right? But that comes at an expense, right? computational expense, computational time. Okay, so in the 5 minutes remaining, let's just